I was 15, and I had a great church I was part of, had hundreds of friends at my church, had all kinds of youth group activities. My dad was huge in youth ministry. That's what he was for. And I had a high school that I was part of. I had tons of friends there. A lot of them ended up coming to my church, but a lot of them didn't. I was on the football team there. I was involved in stage productions there. All kinds of great things there. I had a girlfriend at another high school. If there were things I didn't want to do at my school, I'd say, I can't. I got to be over there tonight. I had a job. I was always after a pay raise at my job. At 15, I had so much going. I was worried that I was going to miss out on something. In fact, I had a fear of missing out. Have any of you ever had a fear of missing out on something? It's called FOMO. FOMO. Fear of missing out. And you know something? We've got a generation of young adults today who are driven by FOMO. Yeah, Time Magazine writes about it. Time Magazine says there are four stages to FOMO. The first one is it starts with a sorrow in a person's life. I don't feel good about myself. Have you ever been there before? I just don't feel good about myself. The second stage is social media. They turn to social media in hopes of feeling good about themselves. That's the worst place you could possibly go to feel good about yourself, because anyone that posts on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter is posting the greatest thing they did in the last 18 months. I mean, everybody's better than you on Facebook. And that turns into this whole issue of happiness is about attention, and I'm not getting enough attention, and it just builds and builds to the point of, why don't I just check out on life? And finally, Time Magazine says, but there is a fourth stage to FOMO, and it's the only hope for FOMO, and it's gratitude. Can you imagine Time Magazine coming up with that? Saying that if you're thankful, if you're grateful for what you are instead of what you aren't, or what you have instead of what you don't have, that's the best way to get out of fear of missing out. I don't want to live with FOMO. There's another one. Have you heard of this one? YOLO. Oh, yeah. You only live once. YOLO. Some of you folks out there are living on FOMO and YOLO. That ain't working too. How is that working for you? That actually comes from an old Latin term, carpe diem, which means to seize the day. It can be a good thing for a believer if we're all in for Jesus Christ. However, YOLO is usually connected to a young person who's getting ready to do something really stupid with their life that they'll always regret. Now, if any of you in this room have been battling FOMO or YOLO, I want you to know this new series that we begin today, entitled Along the Way, this is absolutely a series for you leading up to the crucifixion of Christ. And I want you today to look with me to Luke chapter 9 and verse 51, and in the same chapter, verses 57 through 62. Beautiful passage of Scripture. The Bible says in Luke 9, 51, as the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But you go and you proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Today, the first message in this series, I want to talk to you on this thought. Price check. The cost of following Jesus Christ. Price check. You know, this story comes to us from Luke chapter 9 and verse 51. And there's a part at the beginning of that passage that says, along the road to Jerusalem. So we named this series Along the Way because all of you in this room are on a pathway towards your destiny. Along the way, you're going to connect with others and other situations and individuals that you're going to either impress or you're going to be impressed by. At this stage of my life, I pray every day, God, may I impress others. In other words, may I influence others for Jesus Christ. May I never be influenced by others for the work of this enemy. I want to be an influencer for Jesus and for his kingdom. Amen. But the Bible says that Jesus, along the road to Jerusalem, that he walked resolutely. Resolutely. The definition of this word resolutely is in an admirably purposeful, determined, and unwavering manner, as in, she resolutely refused to be bullied by those around her. Or Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem to die. No. What was Jerusalem at this stage in the game? It was his destiny. He was now going the last time to Jerusalem to be crucified. Jesus resolutely, he made up his mind. Nothing is going to get in my way. Nothing is going to stop me from fulfilling my destiny, which is to come to this earth to show men and women what God is like and to resolutely go to the cross for their sins and resurrect from hell, death, and the grave victoriously that they may have victory over the works of Satan forever. If you believe that, you're saying amen. He resolutely, there comes a point in all of our lives where we're going to have to decide, am I resolute for the cause of Jesus Christ? I love this title, Price Check, because all of you have been to Walmart or some grocery store, and as you're checking out, the checker has lost a price on what you're buying on one of the items. And so what do? They go to this loudspeaker on the left. Price check, aisle 14. Price check, aisle 14. Price check. And what is the supervisor who shows up going to do? They're going to tell the checker what the price is to buy this item. And some people, I think, say yes to Jesus without really considering what the price of saying yes is. And when they desperately need him the most, they have somehow lost out because they didn't follow through with their commitment going in. This first man just shows up and he says to the Lord, I will follow you wherever you go. I'll follow you wherever you go. Jesus immediately says back to him, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Jesus challenged the man's comfortability. I want you to know that there is a romantic side to faith. Say, what do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, most of you in this room who are believers, who are followers of Christ, can remember the individual who led you to Jesus. Something about that individual impressed you to believe the Jesus they serve. You were impressed. You were influenced by that individual. Maybe it happened in a conference or at a church meeting like this, and you were impressed by whoever was delivering the good news. Maybe it was a young man. Maybe it was an old man. Hello. Maybe it was a young woman or an older woman. Whoever it was, they impressed you, and as you listened to them talk, you were thinking, oh, my goodness. If I go with Jesus, I'll be like him. I'll be like her. I'll be in front of people 24/7, in front of large crowds, talking and just saying things, and I'll be able to impress people like they're impressing me. See, there's a romantic side to faith if we're not careful. And what you need to know, church, is that whoever delivered the gospel to you, that is a one-time thing that happened in an event in your life. They try to continue to do that on a regular basis, but in the case of my life, there are hours and hours and hours between speaking times. Do you know what I'm saying? In other words, I'm living life to fulfill the call of God on my life, and occasionally I'm in front of crowds. Don't be impressed by the fact that I'm in front of crowds. Don't say that if I follow Christ, I'll be in front of people the rest of my life. It may or may not happen. The point is, what are you willing to do by following Jesus Christ that he's called you to do? Jesus was challenging this man's comfortability. He had been impressed by Jesus. He was following along the way with Jesus. This man reminds me of Peter. Peter, along with the other disciples, were part of Jesus' tribe. They saw the miracles. They saw the people raised from the dead. They were the cool disciples. They were the protectors of Jesus. In Luke chapter 16, verse 18, along with the other disciples, Peter kept little children from coming to Jesus. And Jesus said, get out of the way. Let the kids come to me. They're like heaven themselves. But that can happen to you when you think you're the man and it's really him who's the man, but you start thinking you're the man. It was a comfortable thing for Peter and the other disciples. And on one occasion, in the midst of all the party and all the victories, all the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus stops and he says, you know, really soon, you, Peter, and everybody here, all the disciples, you're going to turn your back on me. Now, Peter had been living the good life. And he looks at Jesus now, Matthew 26, 33. Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will. Truly, I tell you, Jesus answered, this very night before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. He didn't stop. Peter declared, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the other disciples said the same thing. Now, folks, you and I know that very night, Peter denied him three times, as well as the other disciples who were originally all in with Jesus. What happened was, while it was comfortable, they were all in. But when the crisis came, when the struggle came, you see, friends, it's not during the good times that our faith is built. It's not on the mountaintops. It's not on the fun times. It's not on, did you see that? He was out in the spirit for 2 days. It's not that. It's the valleys. It's the rough times. It's when you say, yes, I can. They say, no, you can't. It's when they come against you. It's when all hell breaks loose. That's when your faith is tested. That's when you step over the lies of the enemy and keep going with Jesus. It's not very romantic. It's not very comfortable, but you keep going with Jesus. Jesus looked at this man, and he said to him, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Because the man had said, oh, Jesus, oh, rock star Jesus, oh, healer Jesus, oh, miracle worker Jesus, oh, feed the 5,000 Jesus, I love you, I'm all into you. But then Jesus says, I don't have any place to stay. What are you talking about? I don't know where my next meal is coming from. Are you kidding me? The question is, have we become too comfortable? Because when Jesus said, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but I don't have a place to stay. The thing that should have been said in that moment was, price check! Price check! Can somebody tell me what this costs? Because I must be misinformed. Here we go. After this happens, Luke 9:59 says that he said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus challenged this man's desire for convenience. When Jesus speaks the Father and the Holy Spirit are speaking. I don't think sometimes people realize in this story that when Jesus was talking, God the Father Almighty, the Holy Ghost Almighty, were also talking when Jesus was talking. Sometimes we take the parables and the stories and the life of Christ, we take it too humanly. We don't realize that every time he opens his mouth, the Godhead is talking. Huh? And when Jesus said, "Follow me," it was the same God speaking as spoke in Isaiah 45, verses 5 through 7, 9 and 10. God said through Isaiah, "I am the Lord and there is no other. Apart from me, there is no God. I will strengthen you, though you have not acknowledged me, so that from the rising of the sun to the place of its setting, people may know there is none beside me. I am the Lord and there is no other. I form the light and create darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all these things. Woe to those who quarrel with their maker, those who are nothing but potsherds among the potsherds of clay on the ground. Does the clay say to the potter, 'What are you making?' Does your work say, 'The potter has no hands?' Woe to the one who says to a father, 'What have you begotten?' Or to a mother, 'What have you brought to birth?'" You know what God is saying here through Isaiah? Who do you think you're talking to? Who do you think you're questioning? You're talking to God Almighty right here, folks. You're not going to question me, God said. And when Jesus said, "Follow me," it was the same God who had said in Isaiah 45, "Who do you think you're talking to?" Some of you business owners in this room, you know which one of your employees are there for your agenda and which ones you're paying for their own convenience. Because they want to get everything you got so they can start their own deal on this side. You know, right now, when I just said that, some of you business, "Oh, that's Marty. That's Marty." Am I right? Some of you educators in the room, you know exactly which children, which young adults come into your class each day just dying to hear you talk. "Oh, I got to learn this. Oh, she's so smart. He's so brilliant. I love this class." And then you know the ones that are sitting there going, "Notes, are you kidding? I got a brain. That's why I have a brain. I don't need to take notes." They'll be in for about 5 minutes, and then they're out the rest of the class. You see, they're not with you. They're not there to learn. They're there to get a grade so they can move on with their life. They don't give a... You know the moment they get out of the class, they'll be making fun of you. They'll be talking about Miss Farkle and how idiot she is. And all you know, they're there for their own convenience, their own agenda. Well, most of you, there's your own kids want to get out of your house. Oh, yeah. "I need more food. That's enough food. I'm out." They've got the plans. They've got items on their list. They've got agendas on their list. They've got all kinds of issues they want to pursue. "As soon as I can get out of here, I can get on with my life." He challenged this man's whole idea of wanting to serve out of convenience. Now, let me make it very clear, church. Nobody in this church who's in leadership is against passing the torch one day to the next generation so this gospel carries on through Trinity Church in Miami, Florida. No one is against legacy. No one. I want to make it very clear. But Jesus had in mind that he would pull some men out of their life. And for 3.5 years, he would pour into them, coach. They would have to leave what they were doing, and they would have to zero in on this deal because he wasn't going to be here forever. And in time, when he finished training them hard, he would be gone, and they would carry it on. That was the plan. And it's still the plan, church. The ones that have taught you before won't always be here. But you need to train hard, listen hard, work hard, believe hard, pray hard with all your heart so that when they're gone, you're carrying on in even a more dynamic way for the glory of Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus runs into this man. And I don't think this man was accidental. I think he'd been with Jesus for a while. And Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him. And he was wanting people to sign up for everything he had to offer so this gospel would be multiplied. Those that would not go full on could not serve. I'm sure many of them could go to heaven. They just weren't qualified to change the world. That's the question today that is posed to every one of us. Do you want to just go to heaven? Or would you like to change the world? They were being offered the opportunity to connect with the King of Kings so that what they could do by themselves was one thing, but what they could do together could change the world. Remember in Luke chapter 10, Jesus had commissioned 70 disciples, sent them out, commissioned. 59 of them backed off. Remember, Judas had a much better plan than Jesus, so he sold Jesus out. Jesus knew this. And Jesus looks at this second man and he says, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." When you hear that verse, some of you go, "Oh, Pastor Rich, my God in heaven, are you telling me that Jesus didn't care about the man's dead father?" Of course he cared, but you're asking the wrong question. You shouldn't be fighting for the guy that's arguing with Jesus. You should be fighting for Jesus. The real question is, "Hey, pal, do you realize that you're talking to God?" He said, "Follow me." And you said, "Hey, you know, I got to go bury my dead dad." Are you kidding me? You're talking to God. God is checking you out. Are you serious? You're going to question God? He knew who he was talking to. A better response from this man would have been, "Jesus, you're asking me to follow you. Are you kidding me? I must have won the lottery. You bet. I'm all in. I'll follow you right now. By the way, if you don't already know, my dad died. My mom's freaked out. They need me at home. But I'm just believing that as I follow you, you're going to take care of my family needs at home." You don't think that Jesus cared more about his dead dad and his mother crying at home than this young man did? Jesus cares about every last one of us. Jesus was saying, "I love him, but I'm asking you, are you ready to go?" Friends, we must all lay aside our conveniences and what we want and what we think is important in order to follow Christ. And with the song, say, "I have decided to follow Jesus. I won't concern myself with that which is convenient. I'm going to follow Jesus Christ." And finally, the last man, Luke 9:61. Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus challenged the distractions in this man's choice. First of all, was this whole issue of comfortability. Secondly, convenience. But here's a man befuddled by distractions. All of this happened along the way to Jerusalem. And I'm telling you, you're going to leave this room today back into the marketplace. And along the way between Sundays, you're going to run into people that you will influence or they will influence you. And God has called us to be the influencers and not the recipients of some high-minded so-and-so that doesn't know Jesus influencing us into their pathway. I am here for one reason, to see people walk away from the enemy and choose Jesus Christ and go to heaven. And along the way, change the world. That is my call. I'll never turn from that. Because God has called us to influence a planet for Jesus Christ. Like that old gospel song says, I'm living this life just to live again. You see, Jesus will never approach you with YOLO or FOMO. He's into purposeful living. There's a reason why you're here. You will live again. Who are you going to serve on this side in order to lead or die on the other side? I'm preparing on this side for leadership on the other side. You go, well, Pastor, I may miss out on something. Really? Have you seen the Hubble cameras from space? Have you seen what you haven't been to yet? Are you kidding me? You're missing it? Yeah, but I could miss out on the clubs. Are you kidding me? You got to be out of your mind. The clubs, everybody gets smashed drunk, wakes up the next morning with someone they don't know. They're miserable. Clubs close at 2. Jesus is open all night long. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going with Jesus. I'm done with closed down centers. I want to go where 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, I have my heart available to Jesus, and Jesus is available to me. And I'm not using him. I'm just being blessed by him so I can follow the mission he's called me to. So I got to go home and say goodbye to mommy and daddy. Now, folks, listen to me. These people that Jesus is talking to along the way, I believe they've been leaning into him for a long time, maybe a couple years. They weren't just random, arbitrary people. See, you had the 12 disciples, but you have those hangers-on. There's always that outer group that kind of, you got to kind of say, okay, you guys got to go home to bed now. You got another day tomorrow. We want to be with you. No, you're going home. We only got room for these 12. I think these guys have been leaning in for a long time. And by the way, Jesus isn't talking to a bunch of junior hires here. The disciples were all in their 30s, so was Jesus. I think these guys that come up to him are about the same age. So he's not asking 12-year-olds to leave their family. He's not asking 13-year-olds not to go home and see mom. He's just saying, listen, I don't want you to go right now. I'm not saying you're never going to see him again. I just don't want you to see him today. I've got a job for you right now. This man had pushback right away. The disciples, as they're heading to Jerusalem, they have a feeling of what this is all about, where they're going, what the purpose of this trip to Jerusalem is. Jesus knows that Judas is going to betray him. Maybe he's wanting to add one or two or three more disciples onto this team because he's got to get this message out after he's gone. We know that after Jesus resurrected, they voted a new man onto the 12. Matthias was voted on to the 12 because Judas had committed suicide because of his rebellion. So here we have these men that Jesus questions and talks to, and he wasn't some kid, he was an adult. I got to go say goodbye to mom and dad. And Jesus wasn't saying you can never see him again. He was just saying, not right now. Not this second. Jesus wasn't long for this earth. He had a job for this man to do right now. But this man is looking for other distractions so he doesn't have to yield to God. Jesus answered this man by saying, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. To me, this verse proves these men were not there by accident. This verse proves that these men had been pushing in for a long time. This man had put his hand to the plow. He had signed up to be a follower, a disciple. And now when Jesus asked for everything, he's distracted. I need to say goodbye to mom and dad. Well, you haven't talked to them in 5 years. You never call. You never write. All of a sudden, oh, look at the bird. Distracted. Huh? Jesus challenges the distraction in this man's life. Maybe they had originally come because of romance. Maybe some of you came years ago because of the rendezvous. So cool. Hip. Just jiving. Way cool. Look at those people up there. So good looking. Cool. Hip. Years have passed. You know what happens with age. You know, gravity sets in. Oh, yeah. Gravity starts pulling on you. Not as hip as you used to be. If hipness drew you, it can't keep you. Too comfortable with the call. And one day there was a price check on that comfortability. Check that out. Price check. He's asking too much. It's disturbing my comfortability. Maybe some of them fell away because of convenience. It wasn't convenient anymore. You know, I came in on Compel Night. Man, they were cutting hair in the lobby and tasering the pastor. We had beds out in the lobby. If we were tired, we could sleep during this. I mean, it was the. Now they're asking me to be on call teams. Now they're asking me to be a part of M28 and go down and feed people under the bridge in Overtown. Now they're asking me to actually get involved. That's not convenient for me. Price check on the convenience. I'm sorry. I didn't have the convenience in the list. I didn't know it would be inconvenient. Some got distracted when they heard price check. I started by talking about FOMO and YOLO. Fear of missing out, and you only live once. Let me just say, friends, FOMO and YOLO are no way of living life. When you think you've covered the day, there's 14 more things that popped up that you could have done and you missed out on. If that's what you're living for, you're going to absolutely go out of your brains. And the insane asylums are just growing by leaps and bounds. You only live once. People are doing crazy things trying to get a better high. Let me tell you something. When you decide, for me, it'll be Jesus. I'm going to tell you something. You'll go through 6 decades of living, and you'll feel like I'm living this life just to live again. You'll be just as excited at 64 as you were at 24 or 14 because you're all in for Jesus. I'm telling you something. The price is worth it. The price is worth it. He always gives back. He always comes back 30, 60, 100-fold. He blesses you in such a way that you can't even imagine that the little you put in, he's blessed you back. That's our God. And today God is calling. What will it take? To say, Jesus, I'm all in. I'm not distracted. I'm not comfortable. And I'm not worried about convenience. I want you more than anything else.